This great composer has died of cancer. He's known hundreds of people in his life, but because of quarrels and because a war was going on, there is hardly anyone at the funeral. This was the worst period of the war for Paris. The city is being shelled. Germans are threatening to take it. France is about to collapse, and hardly anybody notices the death of a man who's now taken to signing himself Musician of France. His wife is there, of course, and Chouchou, his daughter, but hardly anybody else. Now, when the carriage gets there to the end, I want you to run out into the road, look at the wreath for the name, run back, and say to your mother, it seems he was a musician. All right? Good. We'll wait until you are. Turn over! Action!
Forward in the foreground! Steady with the coffin. Steady. Spray the hearse. More water. Okay. Pull away now. Start the zoom. Follow them with the hoses. As much rain as you have, please. Just keep walking on.
It seems he was a musician.
Claude Debussy, born in poverty in 1862, died friendless in 1918. A film based on incidents in his life, his own words, and his relationships with Gabriel Dupont, attempted suicide, Lily Rosalie Texier, attempted suicide, Chouchou, died at the age of 13, Madame Bardac, wife of a wealthy banker, and the man who took most of these pictures, Pierre Louys, pornographer, novelist, photographer.
Gazette.
Okay, thank you.
Oh. How do you do?
How do you do?
I believe you've been having some fun in our beach this morning, then.
You should have done your reporting then.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Mm. The martyrdom of Saint Sebastian. When they first did that, they wanted Sebastian to be played by a naked woman.
Really? Well, you didn't, Are you going to do it all here, then? I mean, I thought he was French.
Most of it here and in London. When we shoot in France, the unions make us double up in all the crews, and we can't afford it.
I see.
That's Debussy, over there.
All right.
This scene is when Debussy is in his early 20s, long before he came to England. He is with Madame Vanier. She was looking after him at the time. He always needed someone to look after him. Always found someone, usually a woman. He gave her singing lessons. She gave him money. You know, he loved gambling at cards, and whenever he lost, which was often, she would slip into his pocket enough change to get him home. And a packet of cigarettes, consolation prize. But it was with Madame Vanier that he first played his own composition in public. She sang the songs he had written specially for her. That's Monsieur Vanier. He liked Debussy, but he doesn't seem to have known all that was going on between the young composer and his wife.
And before he could find out, I met Gaby.
Gabrielle Dupont.
Gaby.
They met when Debussy was 26. He lived with her for 10 years. He was back from the Prix de Rome. He'd won this great scholarship from the Conservatoire in Paris.
Forced labor. I hated it.
Gaby was as poor as he was. He had a good time with her. Debussy was born poor.
My father was a soldier, a shopkeeper, a prisoner, a salesman, a clerk, and a layabout. I never went to school. He wanted me to be a sailor.
He only took up music because of a meeting with Verlaine's mother-in-law. She taught him the piano.
I owe her the little I know about the piano. She knew Chopin.
He needed somewhere to live, someone to love him.
The only memory I have of my mother is that she used to slap my face. I can't afford to live at home anyway. My father expects my music to pay for his billiards.
And Gaby was prepared to be his housekeeper.
To go out and work for you, to do anything you want.
He wanted to be free. Free to roam Paris at night, to meet poets, painters, critics, to row with the Conservatoire, to experiment.
As long as you stay with me.
Now he wrote his music for her.
Gardens in the Rain. For Gaby.
Most of the young students and artists in France in the 80s were impressed by the Pre-Raphaelites, especially Debussy. They seemed to choose the subjects that he himself wanted to do. For instance, one of the things he wrote while he was in the Prix de Rome was based on a poem by Rossetti, the Blessed Damozel. You see, Rossetti's situation was similar to that of Debussy. The poem is about this illiterate Cockney woman, an English Gaby, whom Rossetti is supposed to have loved for her fairy willingness. He double-crossed her, of course, just as Debussy double-crossed Gaby. Art Nouveau, aestheticism. It was all going on in Paris and in London in the 1890s. And they wanted all the arts to be mixed together. Oh, read this. This is by Baudelaire, but Debussy said the same sort of thing himself.
It would be truly surprising if sound were not capable of suggesting color. The colors could not give the idea of the melody.
He saw Turner's paintings when he was in London. He wanted his music to be like paintings, to be paintings in sound. His titles are for paintings, Clouds, Moonlight, Fog. Sketches for La Mer, status in black and white. Start again.
It would be truly surprising if sound were not capable of suggesting color. If colors could not give the idea of a melody, and if sound and color were inadequate to express ideas. For things have ever found expression in reciprocal analogies since the day when God put forth the world as a complex and indivisible whole.
Amen. Oh, can't we go? I'm bored.
Yeah, okay. Ciao.
Wait! Let me show you just one more. Whistler. He called his paintings nocturnes. And Debussy, who wrote three nocturnes himself, said that they were studies in grey. The one I like best is La Fête. A fantastic procession. The vibrating, dancing rhythm of the atmosphere with sudden flashes of light. Is this Lily?
Yes.
Hello.
Hi.
Come along here, darling. I want to talk to you. All right. Can I help you?
That's okay.
Are you cold?
No.
Did you have a nice trip?
It was fine, thanks.
This is Debussy.
Hello.
This is, sorry, darling. This is, our little Gaby.
Hello.
And this is my secretary. All right, shall we go and see the rough cut? All right? No, please, not again. You better keep off that.
What am I going to see?
Did you read that book I told you about?
Most of it.
Oh. I'm surprised. And did you read this chapter about Pierre Louys?
Well, I didn't get that far.
To follow this, you must know. Well, can we hold it for a few minutes, please? Thank you. Debussy is working in Paris. Living with Gaby, or rather, she's working and he's living. He earned next to nothing. Then he met Pierre Louys. Louys was rich. He collected rare books, oriental tapestries, cocktail recipes, betting systems, and as many experiences as money and agility could buy. Debussy became his favorite. Oh, he sponged on him, whichever way you want to put it. Anyway, they were friends and worked together on various projects, most of which collapsed. But Louis introduces him to all sorts of writers. The two of them were going to share a house at one time. He wanted Debussy to come to North Africa and the Middle East with him, but Debussy didn't go. Louis liked young girls. He wrote to Debussy saying that he couldn't get on with the work they were planning because he did nothing with his fingers except unmentionable things. And the music behind this scene is from L'Après-midi d'un Faune. Debussy took the poem from Mallarmé.
We're ready.
All right, wait a minute.
What happened, Louis, the kinky one?
Kinky? He got what he deserved. He lived to a cultured old, dirty old age. Okay? Okay, let's run.
Who's playing, Louis?
I am me. That's me. That's Louis. He wrote a very successful pornographic book, took lots of strange photographs. What he really liked to do was manipulate people, a kind of Svengali. And Debussy was good material for him, always dreaming. At one time, he and Gaby used to spend more time at Louis' home than their own. And Debussy would always be dreaming his way through the strange beauty of all Louis' possessions, dreaming his way through a hot summer afternoon with Gaby. They did play with balloons. I've checked.
Toulet, René, Peter.
René Peter.
Baudelaire. Maeterlinck. Mallarmé.
Yeah.
Louis himself. Wouldn't he based his music on writings of all these?
Yes, 90% of his music started from a painting or a poem or a play. They're just a selection. They were all in Paris. If I put down everyone he worked with or knew well, it would sound like the last straw call of all the Bohemian dead.
Who was Chocolat and Footed, is it?
Clown's friends of his.
Mm-hmm. And the Revue Blanche?
Oh, a magazine. Debussy was a music critic for a time.
According to your list, he was patron pianist of every nightclub in town. What did he do for kicks?
It's all in his music.
What's this gigbe?
It's a poem by Verlaine. He came to London for a time to get away from scandals in France.
But like Debussy?
Like Debussy.
Dansez la gigue.
Dansons la gigue. That's the title of the poem. Everybody danced the gigue.
Sounds lousy in English.
Yes. He wrote it here in Soho in a cafe. The gigue, that's the keel row.
Keel row?
Keel row. It was being played on a barrel organ outside. It's about the streets. Debussy based one of his images on it. It goes like this. Dansons la gigue. Most of all, I liked her dancing eyes, sharper than stars. Malicious, I loved her eyes. Dansons la gigue. She had that fine gift of making her lover desperate and doing it so charmingly. Dansons la gigue. Even more, I liked the ripe feeling of her kiss, especially as she was dead for me. Dansons la gigue. I remember those hours, those embraces, my finest possessions. Dansons la gigue.
Even more, I liked the ripe feeling of her kiss, especially as she was dead for me, dans son la gigue.
Right, you're depressed. You don't know where Debussy is. You have no money. He's going to buy mead, but he'll probably bring back a bit of silk or tatty statuette or something. Okay, walk it through. That's right. Now remember, he was lazy. All his friends said that he was lazy. He never appeared to do any work. He would only write the music he wanted to write. And he would only write it in his own time. He took 10 years over Metternich's play, Pelléas and Mélisande, turning it into an opera. And you didn't understand any of it. You are fed up with him. He is probably with another woman. Or talking. Always talking about things that don't interest you. He won't even give music lessons to help feed himself. You have to look after him. You serve him.
Is he going to be all right, this man?
Well, it depends how much I like him and how much you can hate him.
Hope he's not drunk today.
Exactly, as he always.
Yes, but sometimes it tastes a little too strong and I have to spit it out.
He's a spirited lad. Well, I suppose I'm to be filled in.
Do you know anything about Metterling's spirit?
I know he wanted to shoot Debussy and practiced on the local cats. Yes, I'm aware he was the Belgian Shakespeare and wrote many beautiful symbolist dramas, including The Bluebird and Pelléas and Mélisande, in which Debussy saw the perfect subject for an opera. So he begged Maeterlinck's permission to be allowed to use it, which Maeterlinck very generously granted him.
And 10 years later, very generously took it back again.
I was betrayed. You forget, we agreed that Georgette Leblanc, my mistress, was to sing Mélisande. And you engaged Mary Garden, a Scottish soprano.
Do you honestly believe that that's a true reason? You walk around here like some third-rate clown because you haven't got the guts to face up to the fact that your play was a monumental failure. Furthermore, I find you uninteresting. A self-opinionated bore, and what is worse to me, tone-deaf.
Let's have a drink. And let's have some music!
You hate the music, don't you?
It doesn't go with any drink I've got.
And those on the...
Something I find this music like you.
Loud and vulgar.
Oh!
The whole thing was crazy. Metterling jumped through Debussy's windows, threatened to beat him up with a walking stick, and promptly challenged him to a duel with pistols. He then found a fortune teller who saw Debussy drenched in blood. After that, he tried to sabotage the opera, failed, shot as many cats as he could find, and, honor satisfied, went back to Belgium and Wagner. Crazy.
Hey!
Answer or not. Oh, you never listen to me. I suppose I'm not worth listening to, or talking to, or looking at, or sleeping with, or living with. Oh, I'm not good enough for you. Go on, say it, go on. You never even seem to notice I'm around these days.
That's it. Ignore the statuette, Gaby. Your taste is different.
Debussy, danse profane.
Oh, this is a party. Who wants to listen to that?
I do.
Does anybody want to shake to Debussy? This is supposed to be a party. We're all supposed to be enjoying ourselves, aren't we? Oh, you don't want to listen to that anyway. You're only doing it to annoy me. It's a load of old crap. Oh. Anybody ever have a good time while you're around?
Look, I want to listen to the music. Do you mind?
Hurry! Hey, come on! Where's the music?
Thank you.
Yep.
So bloody miserable. Stuff them down you. I've earned it.
There's your earnings! I've told you before, leave me alone.
I won't waste your
no!
You're rotten, you bastard! You bastard! I'm fed up with living in this bloody place! Why don't you flipping get out and do some work instead of sitting around looking at those stupid statues? I'm fed up with living in this place! There's no clothes, no food.
Leave me alone! I'll give you bloody money!
All right, then, where is it?
Money! It's there! And there! Go on, eat it. Show that to some of your friends. You never understood anything
you
I did!
You ain't mean!
You never will!
You mean! You selfish, you bastard!
You're nothing but a filthy little...
You ain't me! You ain't
get away!
You bastard! You bastard!
Well,
you bastard!
And stop it.
You're lousy! You mean! You're ignorant!
I've got some wine.
You,
please,
I hate you,
stop
I hate
it.
You.
She destroys me. She doesn't understand anything. She hates everything I do.
Don't blame her. This is awful. Now, darling, smell this flower and don't be angry.
Oh, I don't want it.
Oh, how lovely. Oh. I like it. Oh. Cut. Can I have my... script, please. Thank you very much. And my pencil. Thank
was
you.
He really such a bastard? Didn't he ever do any work?
Well, he played in one or two nightclubs. He taught, but mainly he wrote music, and that didn't sell well enough to buy him a decent piano.
What about her? Mummy, wasn't she on the game before she went to Debussy?
Probably. There isn't a great deal known about her. She only seems to have had one friend, Lily. Good. Thank you. It was really lovely. Close-ups after lunch.
After
okay.
Lunch.
Thank you. Is there Pianist there.
And then, Gaby, with her steely eyes, found a letter in my pocket, which left no doubt as to the advanced state of a love affair, with all the romantic trappings to move the most hardened heart. Whereupon, tears, drama, a real revolver, and a report in Le Petit Journal.
You wrote that just afterwards. You hated melodrama in real life. Gaby had offended against your taste.
But you were lucky this time. She didn't die. Now it was Lily. Lily Rosalie Texier, a dress model. Once again, the bohemian life closed in around him and he dreamt his way through it. This time with Lily. And as always, with the help and cash of his patron, Louis. But Louis decided to marry. He wrote to Debussy, write me a wedding march, pompous, lustful, and ejaculatory in character. For he was having, as he said, a volcanic experience. He announced, because of her love for a rich rhyme, Mademoiselle Louise de Heredia is changing her name to Louise Louis. Soon Debussy replied,
please remain seated. Mademoiselle Lily Texier has changed her disharmonious name to Lily Debussy. Much more euphonious, as everyone will agree.
But Louis was gone. His wife disliked Debussy, scruffy musician. And he was dismissed.
No money. To pay for the wedding breakfast, I gave a piano lesson an hour before the ceremony. Lily fell ill. We hadn't the money to carry out the doctor's instructions. I had to support her.
No patron, no one to support his long trances, his rejected work.
Cut. Stop it, for heaven's sake. What are you doing? Come along here.
Well, you don't have to behave like that in front of her. What is it all about, this clowning?
Well, it's difficult to get the feeling that I'm all in refuge in a foreign country.
Well, I don't understand what you're talking about. It has got nothing to do with it, all this clowning. The only thing you are really concerned about is the sea. Madame Bardac and Debussy stayed here whole summer, and it was here he finished writing La Mer, his greatest piece. He used to listen to the sea.
To the sea. But she's not going to accept this. I mean, what's she going to think? She leaves her husband, a position in society, elopes with this composer, goes all the way to exotic Eastbourne, and then he sits down on the beach and listens to the sea. It won't work.
You mean it's all wrong?
Well, it's wrong.
No, it isn't.
Why?
Because she would understand. She wasn't like Lily or Gaby. She was like Madame Vernier or Camille Claudel. She was very intelligent. She was an artist herself.
And she was rich.
Exactly. For the first time in your life, you had no money worries and you could concentrate on your music. And just listen to the sea. Right?
Right.
Good. Let's get on with it. The Grand Hotel, Eastbourne. It was here that Debussy came to get away from the scandal in Paris. Madame Bardac left her husband for Debussy. She was his new patron. Debussy was no longer an enfant terrible. For 20 years he had been absorbed in composition, taking new ideas from poets and painters, slowly working out new patterns of music, ignoring his rejection. His work came out of his long daydream.
Music will begin where words are impotent. Music is made for the inexpressible. I would like it to appear that it came from a shadow, and that from time to time it will return there.
And here, with Madame Bardac supporting him, he finished La Mer, the sea in which all his experiments blended into a new and strong form. La Mer proved him. From now on, he was regarded as a great composer. The listless drifting of garret life was over. The listless drifting of garret life was over, and with it, Lily. He had married Lily, and he had introduced her to his friends. She was very popular with them. She was excited by the new people she met. Life was slovenly and difficult, but to her it appeared secure, sophisticated, different. But Debussy abandoned her when he realized that she had nothing to give him and left her isolated.
And this caused the scandal. It was this that forced Debussy and Madame Bardac to quit Paris.
I have discovered you. It was so charming, just the two of you. Just look at her get-up. You've chosen well, my dear. My congratulations. And your eyes, your horrible eyes, both of you. Tie your tie again properly, you idiot.
That's enough. Get out now, I order you, or I'll use force.
I told you I want to talk. I'm going to talk to both of you, and nothing is going to stop me, not even your threats.
You're crazy. Come away.
No, no.
Don't interfere. Madame has the right. We do owe you.
Oh, God. She doesn't look a bit like Madame Bardac.
Suppose you think you do?
Shh, behave yourself. They are giving a special performance for us.
My most sincere desire is to put right as far as possible the wrong I've done you, and to offer you a life worthy of you, and that of a kind that your husband cannot afford. I know this is only small compensation, but
now it's charity. And your charity! I'd be ashamed to accept it. But if I don't, I can go and die on the bare floor. That's the alternative.
My offer, as I see it, cannot be called charity. Believe me, it will be much more generous than anything that is usually known by that name.
I should hope so. You're taking everything away from me, and you think you are not going to do anything to make up for it? Money. I should say I shall need money, and lots of it. You're rich, you. When one pays for the luxury of getting a man, one should learn what it costs.
Lily.
Congratulations, madame. On this ground, we will understand each other much more. Now, let's talk about the practical side of it first. You will have a regular income.
But I don't want your filthy money. Keep it. Do you really think I would soil my hands with it?
Who wrote this?
Henri Bataille.
It's called The Naked Lady. Everybody knows it. Well, most of it anyway was based on Debussy's own experiences.
Didn't Debussy sue him?
He couldn't do anything about it. To have sued would have been admitting it were true.
Oh, what a mess it all was.
Well, that is a bloody bore anyway. I'm off.
Shut up and stay where you are. It's just that one scene.
I wouldn't say no to Lily, for heaven's sake.
What must I do to remake my life? Run from one man to another to find one who will take care of me? Must I return to prostitution? I couldn't do it. It's your fault. You have given me a conscience. What for, good Lord? Every time I failed you, you dragged me back to the heights. Well, I'm there. At last, I have become the woman you wanted me to be. I can no longer go back. It's finished, and you have a duty to perform. It is me whom you have to keep, and you are going to keep me.
I've made you what you are. I've helped you to attain a certain social standing. I'm leaving you on a higher plane which can serve you as a springboard. Life is far richer in its resources than you think. You can remake your circle of friends. Like everybody else in the world, you can find a better love than mine. And far, far happier. My poor girl, if you know how I'm torn. Torn to pieces.
You see, he has pity on me. You are not going to take him away. You are going to leave him to me. You have no idea what you're doing. Don't do this. Don't do this. Have pity on me. Come away, Pierre. Let's go home now, my dear, my love. You do love me a little, don't you? Let's go home now.
Yes, but this time it happened 6 months after you left her. I don't understand it.
But why all the scandal? I mean, you'd done it before. Other people had done it. And she didn't kill herself.
I know. There is so little real evidence for what happened. Maybe you were a swine with women, as they said. Everybody was against you.
They said that you had in fact told her that she could always make money out of prostitution. Some people said that Debussy's father robbed her when he visited her in hospital.
Brothers List. This public fund set up to provide for Lily. Huh?
Yes. Debussy cut everyone who signed that list. And nearly all his friends did sign it.
And what happened?
He never spoke to any of them again. Not even to me. Louis?
Madame Bardac secured a divorce, and with it, a large settlement of money. Debussy and she were married, but before the marriage, she had already given him his first and only child, Chouchou.
I write only for her.
A ballet, a suite.
To my dearest Chouchou. With her father's apologies for what is to follow.
The first sign began to appear of what was to be a long and agonizing illness.
I began to work on two stories by Edgar Allan Poe, The Devil in the Belfry and The Fall of the House of Usher.
He wrote little. Life was highly respectable and luxurious.
Debussy's luck didn't hold. His wife's income was cut off and he was back looking for money. Everything was more difficult now. He had a daughter to support and a big house to maintain. And although he was very sick, he had to travel all over Europe on conducting trips. Start a BP. He was the leader of a movement in music And so the commissions poured in at a time when all the experiments and struggles which he had undergone were being hauled into the open and thrown up in concert halls and on stages all over Europe.
Ida Rubinstein. It was for her that Debussy wrote The Martyrdom of Saint Sebastian, a big, phony epic contrived to satisfy the ego of an aging Russian ballerina. On the opening night, she caused a scandal, a Jewess impersonating a Christian saint. The whole thing was a flop. And yet, Debussy worked on it as he had never worked before. Why?
For Shushu, with her father's apologies for what is to follow.
He continued with his conducting trips all over Europe, even though he collapsed many times. And contracts. He signed to do films, operas, ballets, anything.
I needed the money.
And sometimes he was so ill that he let others orchestrate his music and just signed his name to it.
It's ugly. Paris is becoming more and more odious to me. And I wish I could leave. Literally, I cannot endure it any longer.
A week later, war was declared. The Daily Telegraph commissioned him to write a piece of war music.
It was to be for Albert, King of the Belgians. It had to include the Belgian national anthem.
Berset's Heroic is possibly the most unheroic and bloodthirsty war music ever written. Now, for the last years of his life, Debussy locked himself away. There is mention of his daughter, but of no one else. His dreaming became a sort of endless, isolated self-communion. Time, place, a pattern of life, none of these had ever mattered much to him. Now they mattered not at all. He was working on The Fall of the House of Usher by Edgar Allan Poe.
Roderick Usher is sensitive, as I am sensitive. He hears and feels everything in the world and tries to force these impulses into his work.
Roderick Usher lived with his twin sister in a large, lonely house. He was morbidly engrossed in his artistic experiments and in his sister.
She died, and he incarcerated her in one of his vaults.
Debussy became obsessed with Roderick Usher.
Working on Usher is an excellent way to steady one's nerves against all sorts of horrors. There are moments when I lose the feelings of things around me. And if Roderick Usher's sister was suddenly to walk into my home, I wouldn't be a bit surprised.
Enormous effort. All his impulses were put into this, which was to be his greatest work. For 12 years, this composition drove him to anguish. And all that he had after those 12 years were two or three sheets of music.
I am Roderick Usher.
violent thunderstorm releases Usher's dead sister from the vault. I am Roderick Usher.